We interrupt this record to bring you a special bulletin. The reports of a flying saucer hovering over the city have been confirmed.
Did you really go out with an alien? Uh-huh. What was it like? Real different.
Becoming Human, a Mork and Mindy podcast. Hey everybody, this is Paula Schaffner with episode 19, Mork's Mixed Emotions, which first aired on February 2nd, 1979. The IMDb synopsis is Mork's attempt to lock up his emotions backfires, and each of his emotions boil, although it should be boils, to the surface. This was directed by Jeff Chambers, who also did Mork's First Christmas, and yes, sir, that's my baby. It's Tom Tenowitch's third Mork and Mindy script, and it's the first one for Ed Sharlock. I'm just going to say right now that in 1997, TV Guide put this at number 94 of their 100 greatest episodes of all time, and I will be sampling quite a bit more than usual of the episode content because of what Robin Williams does and how it has to be seen and cannot simply be summarized or described. We start off with a snow-covered shot of the house, although it's more close-up than usual, and so I don't know what's happening with the orange car outside. Mindy is on the phone with her friend Sally, who we've seen in a couple of the episodes, and she's the one with the baby. We find out that Friday is Mindy's birthday, and she'll be spending it with someone pretty special. She tells Sally that she'll talk to her soon, but of course we don't ever see Sally again, but we'll see if there are any other references to her before the end of this season. Since Mork and Mindy aired on Thursdays at that time, the Friday of that week would have been February 23rd, if that is meant to be Mindy's birthday, and that makes her a Pisces. If it was the previous Friday, then she's on the Aquarius side of the cusp. I think of her more as a Pisces personality, though. There's applause when Mork comes down from the attic, and it turns out that he overheard Mindy on the phone, so he wonders about who this pretty special person is that she'll be spending her birthday with. He guesses Menachem Begin and Jimmy Carter, so it seems like he should also guess Sadat, but instead he guesses Frank Zappa, and then he goes back to a more serious person, which is Pope John Paul, and that's the third reference to that Pope in season one. And of course, the special person that Mindy will be spending her birthday with is Mork. But instead of being happy about this, he says heavy sigh, and it'll be another lonely night for the Pope polishing those little red shoes. Mindy says they're going to go someplace really nice for dinner. They'll laugh, celebrate, and have a really good time. But Mork thinks this is rotten. He does want to be with her on her birthday, but something happened to him last night that's going to affect the rest of his life if he lives that long. While he was sleeping, he had little talking pictures in his head. Mindy says this must have been a dream. And he says it couldn't have been a movie because when he woke up, there was no gum under his seat, which is kind of odd, especially considering he sleeps on a swing.
I don't know if it was a dream or not. All I know is it was terrifying, and you were in it, too.
Me? What did I do?
Don't play dumb. We started off first by going through this human car wash and being covered in shake and bake. And the entire cast of The Untouchables was there, too. And then we ended up in this big hot tub where we played connected out with each other's freckles and bobbed for wet things. And then suddenly, you're in another man's arms. Exit grief, enter rage. And as he turned around, horror, it was me. And then I started to carry on like I wasn't even there. How could I do this to me? No grief, then jealousy. I started slapping myself around, hitting myself all over the place. And there's a little man in the background going, don't worry, it'll be cute, don't worry. And then, as I started fighting and fighting among myself, you said,
that's all right, stop, I'll choose between you.
Mindy, my whole emotional life is passing before me.
So there's a lot going on there in that dream, a lot to analyze. I do have to mention that he gets away with that very suggestive line about them in the hot tub and connecting freckles and bobbing for wet things. And he sees himself as a rival for Mindy's affections. According to the internet, the guy saying don't worry is Robin Williams imitating producer Gary Marshall. Although it doesn't sound like other people's Gary Marshall imitations, but I could kind of see it. Mindy tells him not to worry because this was a bad dream and people have them all the time. Mork says Orkins cut off dreams bleems ago when they cut off emotions. Mindy points out that he says that Orkins have no emotions, but he shows emotions all the time. So he snaps, watch your mouth, but it's more defensive than hostile. He admits that he gets occasional pleasure out of flashing through the raincoat of his mind. It's another suggestive line. But he feels it's different now the emotions have crept into his subconscious.
Last night they snuck out and they had a good old time. They used me. Oh, I feel so cheap and dirty. They'll probably never even call me in the city.
But Mark, showing emotions is healthy.
Really?
Yeah.
Well, Minnie, that's a no-no-no-no for a nano-nano.
He's made a decision, and he doesn't think she'll like it. He's got to stop the emotions before they take him over completely. He's got a little door in the back of his mind, and he's going to round up all the emotions, get them behind the door, lock it, and then hide the key in his foot. And I don't know why he thinks that he can't get it away from his foot. She asks if he won't feel anything anymore, and he says, right on, strike up the bland, making a little pun on that. He says goodbye to her, and he starts to prepare to get rid of his emotions, but she stops him. She can't let him do this to himself. He says that his emotions have been locked up for a long time. If they get out, it'll be dangerous. And he says, talk about sailors on leave. And so this is a foreshadowing of how wild things will get for him when the emotions do get out. She tells him if he's going to study human beings, he'll find out that we can't get along without emotions. He says he has studied them, and he gives as examples World War I, World War II, and Watergate. She suggests that he studied them more closely at work, meaning at the music store. She thinks that emotions are what set us apart from animals. He says on Ork, animals are the only ones who have emotions, and that's the way it should be, according to Prime Minister Fluffy. So, of course, he's going for an easy joke, and this overturns what we had learned about Orkan government in the immigrant episode. And I thought it was odd that Mindy thinks that animals don't have emotions because we know that she used to have a dog and a cat when she was a little girl and she must have seen how emotional they can be. Maybe she means humans can articulate their emotions, but it just felt like an odd line. And of course, we've got Mork seeing the worst of emotions and putting Watergate on a level with world wars. By this point, I have lost track of all the references to Watergate and Nixon, and we are 2 years into the Carter administration, but I believe these jokes will continue for a while longer. We get the usual snow-covered mall exterior, and we hear Cora in voiceover asking, "What's the matter, Eugene?" It turns out that Eugene's pet lizard, Herbie, died. Eugene doesn't know what happened to him. Mork, who's been taking notes, suggests that Herbie ate a rancid fly. Eugene is feeling down, so Mindy suggests he cried to make himself feel better. He says, no way. His dad says big boys never cry. And so Mork writes down, interesting, not showing emotions. Cora escorts Eugene into the practice room, and presumably he's there because he's got a music lesson. Mindy tells Mork that Eugene does cry. She's seen him. Mork asks if this was recently, and she says no, so he says, aha. And since we don't see anything further of Eugene, just want to mention a few things. This is one of the few times that we actually hear about his father rather than his mother giving him advice. There's a little bit of be macho and don't show your feelings kind of attitude coming through. We never do hear anything more about Herbie as far as I know. Eugene is not a big part of this episode, but he is here to show that even children may have trouble dealing with their emotions. And we had seen this with Eugene on the Young Love episode, where he was dealing with young love. And then we get what is one of my favorite minor characters, not even supporting characters, on Mork and Mindy.
Hi, Toots.
Hi. What can I do for you?
Caress me with your eyes.
Say, have you got any disco records?
Yes, we do, right over here. Back, this is the disco section.
I love to hear my chains rattle.
This nameless customer is played by 25-year-old Bill Kirchenbauer, and as we will see shortly, he is already going bald, and that is played for humorous effect. He would return as a specific character with a name and a nickname, and still very much a late 70s swinging but kind of out of it disco loving dude, and it's just a lot of fun. It's very different than his most famous role as Coach Graham T. Lubbock on Growing Pains and the spinoff Just the 10 of Us, but already you can see his comic timing, and like Robin Williams, he was a stand-up comic at that time. The customer asked Mindy for Night Fever by the GBs, and when he leans forward, his toupee falls forward, and then it flips back up when he looks up. And Mindy is trying very hard not to laugh, and of course we can't blame her. She goes over to Mork and, laughing quietly, asks him to wait on the customer. She's afraid she'll laugh in this guy's face. Mork points out that she's hiding her emotions. She says laughter is good, but she doesn't want to hurt the guy's feelings. So Mork goes over to the customer, who greets him with, "Hi, groovy." Mork tells the customer that he brings joy to the world, and the customer agrees because of his natural charisma. And Mork says, "No, it's that silly hair."
What are you talking about?
Well, I've seen wavy hair before, but never hair waving. Look at that. Well, hair today, gone tomorrow.
We get a nighttime exterior of the house, and Mindy is still having this conversation with Mork about emotions. She says that people need emotions and they can't just shut them off. He's still not convinced, and so he says goodbye in different forms, ending with shalom. And he tells her it's been nice feeling her, which is another risque line he got away with. This time when she tries to stop him, she's in the kitchen and he's in the middle of the living room, so she's too far away and she gets there too late. He speaks in a monotone and tells her that the door is locked. His emotions are shut off forever. And she says, so is the Mork that she likes so well.
Don't worry, we can go on having the non-emotional equivalent of fun. There are certain advantages. Watch.
Didn't that hurt?
You bet. Oh, it's killing me.
He says the advantage to this is that he can hurt himself all day without bothering other people. So it's an odd sort of masochistic reason to shut off your emotions, except that masochists would enjoy it. He admits that the door could be opened, but it would be far too dangerous. She calls him really dumb. He tells her that's a nice try, but insults to a man with no emotions are like hay fever to a man with no nose. He robotically walks in front of the couch. She says she hates him like this, and she tells him he's ruining her birthday, although obviously it's not her birthday yet.
Another nice attempt for an earthling, but no match for the incredible hulking will of an orchid.
Darn it, Mork, open that door!
I hear you knocking, but you can't come in.
Mork, you were such a terrific guy the way you were. I mean, you were so much fun to be with, and now look at you, You're unemotional, you're cold, it's like part of you has died.
If you think you can get to me by crying, you're wrong. Mindy, fall back, Mayday system to B's, defense line B, shore up defenses, sandbag tear ducts, think baseball. Ah, once again, I am in control. No problem, I can deal with you as any other person. With invitingly soft skin, rosebud lips, and sweet little eyes that leak cute little drops that roll gently down your cheeks.
I'm getting to you, aren't I?
Not this fella.
Come on, Morky, open up the door. Why don't you show Mindy where you tucked away all those little emotions, huh?
Mayday! 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 All systems overload! Fall back, defense line B! Prepare for assault system!
You show me yours, I'll show you mine.
Never! 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 The door! It's breaking, the door! Mindy, run for your life! The emotions are coming! Free at last! All of your emotions, follow me! I'm not Mork, I'm Mork's lust. Come on now, girly girl. I saw her. Get away from her, jealousy. What the hell are you doing? Don't hurt him. He has a right. Oh, wait, please. Oh,
Mama!
All of your emotions, come
on. We've got a lot of catching up to do. Let's go, boys! Yeah!
Mindy! 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 Ah!
We get the snowy exterior of the mall again, and it's clearly another day, presumably the next day. Mindy has obviously just told her father and grandmother what happened with Mork, and Cora says it doesn't seem possible that emotions could so change a person. Mindy says it's all her fault because she kissed Mork and bingo. Cora says at least Mindy got a kiss. When Cora goes out with a man, it's usually just for bingo. And I felt like that line had two possible readings. One is that Cora dates and doesn't even get kissed, and they end up going to a bingo game. And the other is that she's having sex with men and she's not even getting kissed. Mindy says this is what happens when you bottle up emotions for so many years. Fred tells her not to blame herself because she's only trying to help Mork be like other human beings. And I thought that was interesting for a couple reasons. One, the overprotective Fred of early season one would probably not be as cool with Mindy kissing Mork, although she kisses him a lot. I don't know how much Fred knows about that. And secondly, Fred using the phrase other human beings, he sort of sees Mork as a human being. Mork is not as much of an alien in any sense to Fred as he was a few months ago.
But excuse me! Why didn't you ever sell any of this stuff?
Mork says that that was anger. The other emotions are sleeping it off in his mind. He says it's been a hard day's night, and of course a Beatles reference. He said he would lock them all up again, but anger is standing guard, and anger angrily says, yeah, and I'm a big boy too. And we get a moment of Mork doing his Peter Lorre imitation, and each of these emotions has its own voice, and you kind of have to sort out who's who as you go along. Some of them are celebrities, some are just types. I thought it was interesting that anger is this tough southern, possibly redneck type. Mork says that he's done things that would embarrass Idi Amin. The Ugandan dictator would not be overthrown until later in 1979. Even though Mork said he didn't want to talk about it, Fred asks what happened, and so Mork says that they started off going to the waterfront. Mindy says there is no waterfront in Colorado, and I guess, like, a lakefront doesn't count? It's an odd phrasing, but I think it's implied that waterfront in the sense of an ocean. And it turns out they didn't stay in Colorado, and he hands her some seashells.
We start off by going to this really cheap dive called the ballpark. Fear didn't want to go in, but disgust called him a sissy. And excitement was so titillated by that he went to the bar and ordered 10 beers, one for each finger. Guilt felt so bad about that he yanked us into the alley. Whimsy said it must be named Muhammad. Shut up! Let me finish the story! Okay. Suddenly, we were surrounded by a vicious motorcycle gang. There were 12 of us against 42 of them. Anger still spitting leather.
Mindy asks about the positive emotions, like love. Mork says he doesn't know what he said to that girl at the street corner, but she sold her car and gave all her money to Mork. And street corner suggests that it was a prostitute, but she was in her car. So that's a little confusing. Not sure what's being implied there. Mork doesn't know when the emotions will rise up again, and anger yells, yeah! Mork doesn't want to ruin Mindy's birthday. She says the only thing that would ruin it is if he wasn't there. He says, yeah, you're right, I'm a heck of a guy. And so this was a slightly uncharacteristic line from Mork, who's usually pretty modest, but then again, he is going through various emotions. Presumably for Mindy's birthday, Cora knitted Mindy a red sweater, and it took her 5 weeks. One of Mork's emotions scoffs at the sweater and asks what she used for knitting needles and suggests crowbars. Mork points out that his emotions are waking up again.
I think they're trying to get out and teach me a lesson and show me who's boss.
Not now! It's okay!
See?
We get a nighttime exterior of what is simply labeled restaurant. I thought this was interesting how the scene was shot because we start with a close-up of a water glass being filled and then we follow the waiter across the floor over to the doorway and then Mork and Mindy come in. Mork is in a black suit with a white collared shirt and a red plaid bow tie. Mindy is wearing a beige outfit that honestly looks like something that she would wear to a job interview to be a secretary. He's very nervous, and she gives him a little kiss of encouragement.
Don't worry.
Oh, thanks. That felt real nice.
Now see how nice emotions can be when they start behaving themselves?
Yeah, that was fantastic. That was terrific. Come on, Mama, lay another weapon on me. Come on.
The maitre d' says good evening. Mindy says she has reservations for two under the name McConnell for 8 o'clock. The maitre d' checks his list, and he very obviously wants a tip. Mindy ignores him, and Mork doesn't seem to understand. So then there's no McConnell on the list. Mindy made reservations 2 days ago, so I guess that would be Wednesday. And she says it's her birthday and it's a special occasion. The maitre d' suggests they try again on another special occasion.
Maybe you didn't hear the girl. How about you get to our table right now, tear off your lips, face into your eyes, so you can see what you're going to say. How about that, huh?
Mindy sits down in the chair that's closest to the door, but she says it's awfully close to the kitchen. The maitre d' says this guarantees that the food will arrive piping hot.
I just can't sit next to the kitchen with all that clattering and gibberish and foreign tongues. I mean, Oy vey Maria, this is ridiculous. I mean, if I sit by this tacky swinging door and catch a disease, I'll sue you silly, I will. Oh my God, I'm hypoglycemic, here I go.
Right this way, please. Here we are. This is Chez Michel's finest table.
Oh, it's wonderful.
It's more than that. It's delightful. It's lovely. It's delicious. Thank you. Thank you. This is fantastic. Thank you. Thank you. Oh, sell my clothes. I'm going to heaven. This is wonderful.
And we hope you have a safe and speedy trip.
Nanu, nanu.
Mork says he didn't know his emotions could work so well for him. She says that they're still coming out a little too strong. He says if it wasn't for the emotions, they would be celebrating her birthday at Biffy Burger, and I assume that's not a real place.
Bonsoir, mademoiselle, monsieur. Might I recommend the Chateaubriand with sauce Michel and carrots glacé? And to begin, salad endive with dressing polonaise.
That sounds terrific.
Very well, mademoiselle.
Oh, by the way, do you have a Thousand Island dressing? It's my favorite.
I'm so sorry. We do not carry Thousand Island dressing.
That's too bad.
No Thousand Island dressing? Oh, please. Those are her favorite little islands. Oh, this is terrible, Mindy. Oh, Mindy, this is... I can't go on. Mindy, I can't go on. It's not worth
it. Please, tell him I'll get some from the 7-Eleven. And if you need anything else, my name is Butch.
And I have to point out that you can kind of see him almost cutting his wrists, which is pretty dark for this show. Mindy tells him to hang in there. He's doing okay, which is debatable, but it's sweet of her. And he says he owes it all to her. She looks over at the older couple at the next table, and they're eating lobster, and now she wishes she'd ordered that.
Yeah, me too. I wish we could have things like that. I never have anything any good. Yeah, it's because you're so damn wimpy, that's why. Why don't you get it for me? All right, I'll get it for you. Come on, we've got to change this world. We're going to build someplace new. No problem, excuse me. You've been on top long enough. Give me that, you bourgeoisie pig. Give me that hair. You don't need this either. Oh, look. What a way to end a honeymoon. Poor little creature.
If you listen carefully, you can hear him making some class remarks, like calling them bourgeois pigs and saying that they've been on the top too long. And of course, the lobster thing about the honeymoon sounds vaguely suggestive. We go back to the apartment, and Mindy says that she's worried about Mork. Unless he can get his emotions under control, he's going to be scooped up by a net. Like an insane asylum is going to come and catch him with a butterfly net. Like the song, "They're Coming to Take Me Away." Mork says Frankie Avalon didn't mind being scooped up by Annette in all those movies, and of course that's an Annette Funicello joke. He does his bark laugh, which Mindy imitates. Mindy is puzzled why he views emotions as alien creatures. Emotions are part of Mork. She suggests that he sit down and talk to his emotions. Mork says that the emotions wouldn't talk to him, which I thought was interesting, that that's how he sees it. Maybe he has tried when they went wild. Maybe he was trying to reason with them and they just ignored him. So she wants to talk to them, and Mork calls her a brave woman, which she is. in subtle ways, Mindy is very brave.
Yoo-hoo, anybody home? Ollie, Ollie, Freud's in free. First one home is an archetype.
Yeah, what do you want?
Now, I'm not gonna know who you are unless you identify yourself.
Anger here, fly brain.
Now, Mork just wants to try to get along with all of you better.
Why don't you just tell Mork to...
Now, I don't know how things got the way they are on Ork, but here on Earth, a person needs his emotions.
Yeah.
Disappointment here. I hate to bother you, but things aren't the way we thought, you know? I mean, it's not like home. I mean, the trees are green, the birds have wings. It's bizarre.
Really? Fear here. I don't want to tell you this, but, you know, it's cold and lonely, and no one likes us, and no one hears the voices like we do, and they're going to hurt us. I know they are. Please, don't you understand me?
No, nobody's going to hurt you. Don't you understand it? You're free on Earth. You can do anything you want.
Disgust here. Now, listen, we've done our gig, and you don't even like it when we do. Listen, I want to blow this popsicle stand. Besides, who wants to live in a house that looked like Sears blew up?
Really?
I mean... Hope here. I just want to say thanks for the memory.
You see, Mork needs to work with all of you to be a feeling person.
Yeah, Mindy's right, you guys. How about it? I'll make you a deal. Tell you what, you don't go wild, and I won't lock you up in semi-brain, okay? Yeah, what's in it for us, pork face? All right, you said you're lonely?
Oh, yes, please, we're so lonely. You've got to do something.
All right, I'll make you a deal. You stick along with me, and I'll introduce you to Mindy's emotions. All right, let's see what we're gonna get out of this. Stand up there, sweet girl. Let's check the noise out here. There, look on that. I'm a good set of teeth. All right, we got that going.
Boy, who buys her clothes? It's ridiculous.
Mindy, we'll be right back. We'll get to you. Huddle up over here now, boys. Huddle up. What do you think now? Come on now, sit down.
I don't really understand why we're doing this.
Come on, be quiet now.
You don't understand. He's not working out anyway.
Break!
Well?
I've got mixed emotions.
And yes, he makes a Bob Hope joke, although not really much of an imitation. He tells her that some of the emotions want to come out and some don't. She says that sounds human enough, and that's true that, you know, sometimes humans are more comfortable with different emotions at different times.
What emotion are you feeling right now?
Gratitude. Thank you, Mindy.
Oh, I like gratitude.
Here's one from Joy. Oh, that was fantastic! Thank you! Woo! One from guilt, okay? That's okay. Oh, I'm gonna burn for this, I know it. One from envy. Wow, how come I got to kiss you on the cheek and everybody else got to kiss you on the lips? Boy! One from fear. Oh... Hope I didn't catch anything. Here's one from all of us. We... I care for you very much.
We get the usual thing of Mork summoning Orson from the couch, but in his mind, he's in a very penitent position. He's got his hands clasped over his crotch, and he's looking down, and he uses a quiet voice. Orson, maybe because he's been in Mork's mind so often, knows that Mork opened the door to his emotions, and Mork says, "Yes, sir." Orson says that Mork has broken the highest Orkin law, and I didn't realize until this episode, I guess, that that is the highest, that that is the absolute worst thing you can do, is to let all your emotions run amok. I knew that Orkins disapproved of emotions, but I didn't know it was to that extent. Orson says it's his duty to report Mork to the council, and again, I'm still fuzzy on how Orkin government works, where Prime Minister Fluffy fits into this. But I think the council may have been mentioned in an earlier episode, and I sort of think of them as those figures that we see in the opening credits. Orson is probably one of them, but the other figures may be the council. Mork quietly says he understands.
I don't regret what I've done, sir. You see, for the first time in my life, I feel really alive. I feel fantastic. Oh, I wish you could try it. I wish you could feel some of the things I've been feeling.
Impossible. I could never do that. They'd throw me in prison.
I don't mean to be disrespectful, Your Immenseness, but until you can marvel at a rainbow after a storm, or rejoice at seeing a baby walk for the first time, or hold someone and feel the same warmth inside as you feel close to them on the outside, until you can do these things, aren't you already in prison? When will you report me, sir?
Report you? What for?
You're all right, your fat attitude. Until next week, Nanu Nanu. I knew he had it in him.
I thought these were very telling examples. The rainbow, of course, is very important to Mork, as we see in his clothes, and it's a symbol of hope. As I've said before, there's now a queer connotation to that that was not intentional in 1978 or 79, but is still nice to see. He talks about babies, and we saw how he's recently started to have fatherly feelings about holding babies and seeing them grow up. And he talks about holding someone special, and we know he's thinking about Mindy. We see that Orson is just going to ignore the law breaking. He's going to pretend that he knows nothing about this. And I guess, hypothetically, they can get away with this. I think Mork is so far from Ork that nobody but Orson has to know that he is having emotions. I don't know how this is going to impact his various reports, but maybe Orson is editing the emotions out. So I was actually a little bit wary of this episode in the sense that when something is described as classic, it's very hard to live up to. But I did actually enjoy this episode. I hadn't seen it for a few years, although some things came back to me not from the time, but from my last viewing. It's funny. It's moving. It's thought-provoking. It is still an impressive tour de force for Robin Williams, playing all these characters within one person. And he says that there are 12 of them. Like I said, I didn't keep track. Obviously, anger and fear, disgust, envy, jealousy, hope, delight, and so on. And then I guess some sort of composite Mork, which may be the 13th, I don't know. But he shifts back and forth. We've seen Robin Williams play different characters, but this whirlwind of it is amazing. And he does something a little bit similar in Aladdin, for instance, but there it's a bunch of different celebrities to have to play different emotions and give them each personalities within a sitcom setting is impressive. We don't get a lot of Fred, Cora, definitely not much of Eugene. They're used well in their little bit. Primarily, we're seeing how Mindy reacts to these emotions and lack of emotions and all the different things going on. We don't learn a lot about her in this episode other than her birthday, but I do think she's brave, and I do think she is wonderfully warm and supportive. She loves Mork. That is very clear. She wants him to be the best person he can be, and she wants him to experience all his emotions, although she does explain that there's a time and a place for some, and you do have to control your emotions, or at least the expression of them. As when he wanted to take himself off the planet because he was worried about how sad she would be, and then she kissed him and reminded him that whatever pain separation may bring someday, right now, they're very happy together. In this episode, we repeatedly see kissing as a form of connection. Sometimes, if lust takes over, it's not something that either of them is prepared for, and certainly not something that should be expressed in a fancy French restaurant. There are those different forms of kissing and that pattern and how she kisses him and he kisses her. And then that final nose-to-nose, eye-to-eye look, that classic image of Mork and Mindy. Despite the ridiculous frilly bow she's wearing, it's lovely. It's a funny episode, a naughty episode. I talked about this before, that Mork is like somebody from a strict religious background who's going a little bit crazy in a permissive environment. And yet, even there are limits. Impressive all around. Very enjoyable. Yes, one of the best episodes of the series. Certainly one of the best of season one. On the 0 to 4 egg scale, which measures how well an episode fulfills what I'm looking for in the series, I'm going to give it a 3.5. I do think the restaurant scene is a little bit weaker than it could be. The guest performances are nice, and I should mention all of them before I continue with my rating. So I already talked about Bill Kirkenbauer, who was awesome. But at the restaurant, we have the maitre d' played by George Pentecost, and he was somewhat of a Gary Marshall regular in the sense that he had a recurring role on Blansky's Beauties in 1977, and he also appears on Laverne and Shirley, and he would have two more Mork and Mindy roles. You know, I've seen this snooty maitre d' character on different series, and he does all right. I mean, I wouldn't say it's a classic. There's a better one on Who's the Boss, for instance. But he does okay. As the French waiter, we get Peter Elbling, who had 4 different roles on Laverne and Shirley, and basically using a different accent in all of them except for the episode where he's asleep. And he does fine. I like the little joke at the end that you can call him Butch, so that we get this little hint that he's not actually French. It's just something he puts on. Then there's the waiter, Stan Rodarty, who is uncredited, but IMDb mentions him, and he mostly had uncredited roles, and I think he was the one pouring the water. Not real memorable. Having seen episodes where supporting characters can really make a difference, like Mork the Gullible, I didn't feel that the restaurant staff were on the level of Bill Kirkenbauer, who's hilarious and adorable, and I'm so glad they had him back. Not a 4 on a 0 to 4 scale, but almost everything I could want. Would like a little bit more of the other characters. Although it's fun to see Robin Williams go to town as Mork, sometimes I feel like we don't get enough of the other people. We could have got more, for instance, Fred and Cora reacting to Mork. On the 0 to 4 heart scale, which measures the likely romance of Mork and Mindy, this obviously, with all the kissing, has to rank pretty high. And we get another reminder of how important they are to each other and how important Mork's whole self is to Mindy, that she does not want somebody bland and emotionless. She wants Mork. Even though he causes trouble, that's who she cares about. That's who is important to her. And Mork recognizes in this episode that Mindy is his rock. And she's also the one who is releasing emotions in him, and that is a little scary. So there's sort of this dual image she has for him, but as we see in the tag, holding her and being held by her is very important to him. I'm going to go with a 3. I had said recently that I didn't think we'd be getting any 3-heart episodes in season 1, but I just honestly can't see them as platonic in this episode. It's beyond best friends, and there is this romantic and sometimes sexual connection between them. Cora talks about them as a couple, even when Mindy's describing something that is not a date. We have Fred accepting him more and more. We have Sally, who very recently was teasing Mindy about making babies with Mork. I'm guessing that Sally on the phone knows exactly who the special person Mindy is spending her birthday with is. There are some lines in the episode like makes it sound like there's going to be a party or a bigger dinner. It's just a dinner for two at a French restaurant. That is almost by definition on a sitcom a date. 3 hearts. This episode is highly recommended for many reasons. 94 best episodes ever, maybe not, but I think if you watch it, you won't be disappointed. I'm going with 3.5 eggs, 3 hearts. This is Paula Schaffner with Mork's Mixed Emotions. Nanu, Nanu!
Someone call the doctor. Gotta- naked girl changes clothes. 'Cause you're hot.